into the online broadcast network, AfterBuzz TV. Over 20 million weekly downloads in over 150 countries and your number one source for after-show entertainment. AfterBuzz TV, the destination for TV superfans, producing aftershows for over 300 of your favorite TV shows, interviewing celebrities and showrunners, and bringing you behind-the-scenes exclusives. All thanks to E! Entertainment's Maria Menounos, producer Kevin Undergaro, and internet leader Akamai. Now, let the buzz begin!
Vikings don't dance, Vikings kill.
Welcome AfterBuzzers to, you know, season 4 for Vikings. You're right here on AfterBuzz TV. It's amazing to have you guys. Make sure
you guys subscribe.
If you guys are on iTunes, subscribe. We are reviewing today Vikings season 4, episode 1, A Good Treason, and episode 2, Kill the Queen.
The Queen,
yeah. My name is Jaco. You guys can catch me on social media, on Twitter, at Jaco. And I'm joined by my lovely co-host.
Oh, thank you. He said I'm lovely. How about that? I'm James Simmons. You guys can find me all over social at AskTheNP, as in nurse practitioner. AskTheNP.
NP, very well. Do you feel that music? Can you guys hear that music?
Doesn't that do something to you? Stirs up this thing and you get all like, where's my machete?
My axe. Let's break it down for these guys. Vikings has not been on AfterBuzz TV, and
This is it.
And it's time. We're starting off season 4. We're going to do 2 episodes at a time until we catch up. And then as soon as we're done with season 4, we're going to go back and start with season 1 to give it all.
Because you guys have been asking for this. You want this. Everyone's watching
We've been asking for this, James. And finally, it's time.
Dun, dun, dun.
It's time.
So did you guys get that? Season 4, but we're starting with episodes 1 and 2 tonight, all right? I know you probably might have just finished watching episode 5 it is, right,
Jaco? Yeah, 5 or 6,
But we're talking about episodes 1 and 2. Episode number 1, A Good Treason.
A Good Treason, that's good. So now, we are going to break this episode down. It's new for us, so we're going to do storylines. If you guys like it, if you don't like it, make sure to let us know in the comments. You can also grab us on Twitter with the hashtag ABTVVikings. To talk to us and let us know how we're doing and what you guys think about the episodes.
Absolutely, because it's all about what you guys want to talk about. We have our feelings here, but we want to know what you think. Let's have a conversation about this kick-ass show, man. Vikings. So we come right into season 4, episode 1, this opening. And this is it, man. Everything that every Viking lives for is getting into Valhalla, right?
Valhalla, that's where it is. The gates are there. It's big. Ragnar is standing in front of the gates and he's ready to go. He's on his deathbed and, I guess in real life.
Right. But we don't exactly know that right away, right? We're like, is Ragnar really like,
is he healthy again?
Valhalla? What's going on?
Nobody knows what's going on.
What's with this dude? And we haven't seen everything in like a year. We're like freaking out. We're like, that's Valhalla. Clearly, you can see it's Valhalla. And he starts running toward it like every good Viking should, man.
Sure. I mean, it's time. It's time. I've been his guy's killed so many times. He's almost been dead so many times. It's time for Valhalla.
Hasn't he, though?
And the gates close on him. Why?
Maybe it's not his time.
I'll tell you why.
Jaco knows why.
I'll tell you why. Uh-huh. James, it's not his time.
Dun, dun, dun. What a very good Christian thing to think, right? Well, ooh, it's not my time.
I mean, he needs to live out through...
Thank you for picking that up, Steve.
That's our very, very hilarious engineer there, Steve.
He's so sweet and so nice.
On the dun, board, dun, dun. Playing our music. So you can play it now, Steve.
There it is, boom, Steve. Which is kind of how Ragnar feels, right? Like he like rips his, you know, gown open or whatever, and he's like screaming like, oh, let me in, and he not your time, da, da, da.
Da, da, da. So not his time. So that's the opening scene, and then also we have his queen talking to the seer saying, you know, is there going to be a woman queen king of the Vikings? And then the seer asks him, after
Ragnar dies, after is that Ragnar what you dies. mean? And she's like, mm-hmm, I'm over this lady. I don't even like her. Queen Aslaug or Aslaug? Aslaug. I'm over her. From Jump Street.
I've disliked her from the very beginning since he came. He messed up beautiful relationship between Ragnar and Lagerthaand.
Totally.
And that just almost ruined it for me, but I kept in it, you know, because I like Vikings so much.
Mm-hmm. But Lagerthaand is clearly his like soulmate, right? Regardless of what happens, like they're like ride or die, and Queen Aslaug clearly is not, but Ragnar is so. I mean, we figured this out, right? In the last three, now four seasons, that Ragnar's all about having his sons and his legacy, and she's the only woman that can give it to him. But now, right away, we start off in this episode and we see that she's not in this because she loves Ragnar. She's in this for the power.
She's not in this because she loves Ragnar.
No.
That Ragnar doesn't love her. Like, no. That's, they kerfuffled in the beginning and way back in the season, and that's about where the love stopped, you know?
Wait, what is that? Is that an Afrikaans word?
That's Afrikaans word.
Kerfuffled?
Kerfuffle.
Kerfuffle.
Kerfuffle, you know?
You will learn something every time you tune in and watch AfterBuzz TV Vikings After Show. Mm-hmm. Not only about the show, but Jaco will teach you a little Afrikaans.
It's almost like, it's speaking Viking, basically.
It is.
Yeah, but, I mean, Vennings the Viking. We're gonna hashtag that.
You are. Vennings the Viking.
So we've got the beginning, the opening scene is pretty intense, brings us back to reality. Mm-hmm. Ragnar is not going to Valhalla, he's not gonna die, he's still alive. So breaking it down, let's go to Kattegat, James. Let's break down what happened at Kattegat, where this is obviously now where Ragnar lives and his queen.
You got it. And listen, guys, this is the format we're gonna take with this as we recap these episodes. But if you have feedback, if you don't like it, if you wanna talk about us talk about something differently, or in a different way, let us know in the comments, all right? So in Kattegat, we're flashing back and forth, and all of a sudden, Bjorn is back, right? Bjorn comes home from Paris, and right away, he starts talking with Queen Aslaug, and there's already like a little thing there, isn't it? There's like Bjorn knows.
Well, nobody likes Queen Aslaug. Yeah. I mean, I think, established that. So, sorry for that. We like you as a person, just not the character, obviously.
Right, and Bjorn finds out, Jaco, sorry to interrupt, Bjorn finds out he has a daughter?
Yeah.
While he was away?
Yep.
What the hell?
Yeah, and he doesn't want to look after her. So, I don't know where, this is funny to think how Ragnar is all about kids, and he sees he's got a doctor. She'll be a doctor one day. A daughter. And kind of just kind of lifting his nose and looking at her. And then Queen Aslaug saying a good thing, saying, don't worry, we'll take care of her.
I got him. I got him. We'll take care of him. And Bjorn, I think they went over that so fast. I thought they were actually going to really dig into that could be maybe an interesting storyline, because Thorin left, you know, and she left behind this daughter. They don't get back to it at all the rest of the entire episode. It's like, all right, Bjorn's got a daughter, cool, thanks. But there has to be a reason they told us that, right? Like, we need to know this. Well, character development, like what?
Development, exactly. I think it's going to come in later in the show, as the show develops. We might have that. But at this point, Bjorn is like, I ain't got no time for kids.
Nope.
Sorry, let's get to the main thing. Maybe he's held up with now running the Viking clan, because Ragnar at this point has not woken up yet. So now he's on the rock giving speeches.
Right, and he gives that epic speech on top of the rock, remember? And actually, this is a little bit of a coming out time, I think, for Bjorn, because Bjorn is constantly trying to prove to Ragnar that he's worthy of being his eldest son and one, you know, raiding and doing all of this stuff. And he's kind of kicked some ass in battle.
He has.
But then he goes and gives this like really impassioned speech on top of the rocks. And does he take it a step too far, though? Because he's given this speech. He's got everybody's fired up. And he's like, oh, yeah, by the way, I'm arresting Floki. No.
Yeah. So now what? Floki is standing there. He knows that, you know, you felt the same way back in the day.
Right.
So he's like, admit it. But so now Bjorn is, you know, hail Ragnar. It's all about Ragnar. He's not awake yet. He most likely will be the king, trying to fill his shoes.
Right.
Nobody asked him to, but I guess that's what happens back in that day.
When you're the son, right.
Yeah.
Are you just expected to try to take on that role? And I think right away I was sort of cheering for Bjorn. I'm like, yeah, get him. You can do it, man. Get in there. But then he like arrests Floki. Yep.
And he's also saying, you know, Floki, it's because of Athelstan that we found Paris. It's because of Athelstan that we have this.
Mm-hmm.
And basically, you know, shaming Floki. And Floki looking humiliated there. And I think I would feel the same way, because you're standing there and everybody standing against you because you've got all these riches now around you, right,
absolutely,
James?
Yep.
And everything went well and you got what you want, and thinking that Athelstan gave that to you, and then that flock, he killed Athelstan.
And then, right. And why? Why did he kill him? And you know, Bjorn thinks he's doing the right thing because he knows that his dad was best homies with Athelstan and is now really sad that he's dead, and Athelstan is either in heaven or Valhalla, who knows, right?
Mm.
What is he? Is he actually Christian?
Maybe he's not really dead.
Dun, dun, dun.
Dun, dun, dun.
Maybe he's not. Yeah, thank you, Steve. I feel like this whole damn show could be like that. Dun, 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 because there's so many of those in the show. So clearly, though, you guys know in this episode, man, I'm jumping ahead a little bit, Jaco.
No, go for it.
This totally backfires on Bjorn. He thinks he's doing the right thing by arresting Floki, and it just does not, it's not a good thing. It doesn't come to pass because the man, the myth, the legend literally wakes up.
There it is.
Boom. Guess what, guys? I'm not in a coma anymore.
Wakes up from his wounds. How do you feel? Oh, I'm alive, you know, so...
What does he tell his little boy? Get me an ale.
Yeah, so if you want to be useful, get me some ale, yeah.
Uh-huh.
So he gets his ale at the dinner table with, you know, there, and talking to Bjorn, saying, well, you had no, you know, why did you make this decision? Because mm-hmm. he felt it's right. Who decided to leave Rollo in Paris?
Ugh.
Come on, Bjorn!
That's another one, man.
Dude, golly. Okay, so you...
But he thought he was doing the right thing. He thought he was being smart.
No, no, James. This Bjorn has been around the block. He's uh-huh. been there,
uh-huh.
right? For, what, 3 seasons now?
Yes, as a child and then
he's been there when Rollo was, you know, against Ragnar before.
And still falls under the trap of Rollo. How does Rollo get people to do this? This is what I don't understand. His character development is turning out to be something really kind of interesting, because you're just like, he's the punk brother. I think he's younger, right? Is he younger?
Yeah, he's the younger brother.
He's the punk younger brother who like wants to be his big brother, and every, you know, he's jealous of Ragnar. And we hear about that in season 3, right? He's a little bit jealous, but
he wants Lagerthaand, he wants in the yeah. season 1, everything.
He tries to rape her in the one scene. I mean, yeah. It was awful, right? It was horrible. But how does he keep getting people on his side?
Well, did you see his bod?
But did I see his body? Whew.
I mean, okay, Lord. So maybe that's one way. But he's charming. Yeah. James.
Sorry, I got a little hot in here.
Yeah.
I do like that Rollo takes his shirt off a lot, though.
Yeah.
I am a big fan of that.
It's crazy his development as a character. You follow him, and then you don't follow him. And then you do, and you hate him, and you love him. And then he fights for his brother. And then, you know, it's just crazy how mm-hmm. they wrote this character.
Mm-hmm.
But going on, we've got at Kattegat still. Queen Aslaug and I'm not saying the name right there, but Ragnar sees each other, and both of them are like, nah.
Isn't that great?
Nah.
And even when he comes out to the party, you know, because they're always partying, right? If they're not fighting, they're partying. This is why we watch, because everyone wants to either be fighting or partying. So Ragnar comes out to this party, and he like stumbles out, and everyone claps, yay, Ragnar's back. And what's the first line he says? She's like, oh, Ragnar, it's so nice to see you.
Of course it is.
Right? Of course it is, because I'm Ragnar. But he's like...
Everybody likes to see me.
Some are more happy to see me than others.
Yeah.
Like, right away, dude has been in a coma for we don't know how long, but a while, because his sons are growing up. You know, he's like, oh, you've gotten so much bigger. And he comes out to the party, and there's him and his wife, like, cool.
But, so, James, you're at this point, just before he comes out, the kids are, you know, fighting, we're training to fight, and... telling their mother, queen, you know, the queen, and she's like, that's mm-hmm. great, but hopefully you guys will inherit the fighting skills of your grandfather, which is the real warrior,
uh-huh.
because Ooh. He slayed the dragon.
The dragon, supposedly, right? We
Come
still
on.
Haven't learned
Get
whether
over
or not
yourself.
That actually happened, right? And she's like...
Yeah, because dragons isn't real.
Yeah, are they, though?
No, they're not real, unless they were the Komodo dragon.
He slayed a Komodo. Do they have Komodo dragons
Not
in Norway?
There. I think it's more like
no,
a tropic
I think
thing,
it's too
but
cold. They might have Komodo dragons in South Africa.
I don't even think they do.
No.
But there definitely no Vikings there. But so yeah.
No. There's some Vennings there, but there's no Vikings.
thank you, James.
You're welcome.
Definitely no Vikings. Yeah, I got
right.
that.
Uh-huh.
So we've got Floki out there. You know, he knows that Ragnar's awake. asks Helga to set him free. She's like, no. So at this point, Floki is captured. Now we're going to get to that a little bit later.
And what was that about? When he asks Helga to set him free, that was really interesting as well. Did he mean to kill him? Is he asking Helga
to
kill him? And is that how he's free? Because then he's in Valhalla, supposedly. Or I don't. She seemed really upset by the question.
She said, and like she almost like, how can you ask? Like asking if you want to do, you know, something weird in bed. It's like, no. Like what?
Right,
no.
Right. Why would I help you? You're my husband. How dare I? Like whatever.
So a little bit of a spoiler. And in season, you know, season two, whatnot. He's running away. I think if he wanted to be killed, he would have just killed himself. So I think he means at that point that set me free, as in I want to escape. I want to run away.
Good point. Good point. And she was for some reason upset by that. Though later on, maybe she actually does help him escape.
Yeah, well, we'll get to that in a second.
Dun, dun, dun.
James, so we've got that. We've got at the end, basically ending off the Kattegat storyline for this episode. Bjorn.
This dude, he's got the thing. I suppose this is everything that every son has with their father, I suppose. I need to prove you right, particularly in Vikingdom, especially when he gives this big impassioned speech.
Speech, I mean, in that whole culture of Vikings, I mean, if you can fight, you can fight, but can you survive?
Survive,
the elements,
exactly.
Everything, prove me wrong. But I feel like the good dad that Ragnar is, I feel like he should have cut him a little bit more slack.
You think so?
I do think so. Because yes, the kid made two stupid mistakes. Okay,
Ragnar. Yes, he did.
The point.
Those are huge mistakes. Jaco.
Huge mistakes.
Huge.
Okay, huge mistakes.
Ginormous.
Because now Ragnar basically has to kill Floki, but Ragnar did not want to handle the situation like that because he still loves him. He's still his friend, and now what we didn't speak about is Bjorn has put him in a position where he has to basically act out what finished off what Bjorn started.
Right, because Ragnar can't come across as weak to his people.
He's the king.
Right, and if someone betrays him or backstabs him who isn't Floki, that's easy. Whack. Axe to the neck. Right, you guys know that's how they roll in Vikings, man. Like, you stole the last piece of bread. Slice, like you're dead.
Slice.
So this is easily, I'm surprised they didn't do the eagle wings thing on Floki too. Like, that's where I thought that they were going.
No.
So Ragnar clearly has to address this, right? And Bjorn, unfortunately, puts him in that tough position of having to address it in a really aggressive way. That's unfortunate.
That's unfortunate. So that's the one problem, right? Mm-hmm. The other problem being leaving Rollo. And we all know what's going to happen there if you watch it in the season, but we'll get to that in a second. With all this happening, ending off the Kattegat storyline, Bjorn says to Ragnar, he's leaving. He's going to check out the wilderness. Mm-hmm. And then Ragnar ending it off saying, well, you know what? Prove me wrong. Like,
right, which in essence is saying, Bjorn, you were right, because Bjorn was like, I'm gonna go out into the world because you don't think I can do it. And then Ragnar's like, yeah, prove me wrong.
Thanks.
That's gotta feel crazy. Like, your dad is like, yep,
thanks dad,
you're not cool. You might have killed like 1,000 English dudes in Wessex, a bunch of French people. You might have brought back this
and some other Viking somewhere up in the beginning.
But you can't survive on your own, especially not in the winter. You're not my son. Oh, that's rough. I feel for Bjorn a little bit. I think we're supposed to. We're supposed to feel for him a little
bit. Yeah, but he's giving up. Like, just leaving, you know, if two mistakes, leaving. It's not like he's getting kicked out. But it is big mistakes. We'll leave it at that.
They were huge mistakes.
We'll continue Kattegat episode 2.
Right. We'll get back to Bjorn a little bit. So this is a nice way to transition into Bjorn's mother.
Lagerthaand. Yeah.
And her earldom, or not earldom, of Hedeby. Man.
Yep.
At first, I wasn't jiving with this. I was like, who is this other dude taking over Lagerthaand's stuff? This
is coming from season 3 now, you know, in a while ago. These two guys sharing the earldom and going into the fight in Paris, they were against each other. The one saved the one's life, the other one saved the other one's life. They're going back, and obviously suddenly now, boom.
Boom.
Love it. Chomies, we're going to be chums, and we're going to run this empire together, which I immediately thought, James, guys at home, big mistake.
You think so?
Of course. This is Vikings. It's freaking Vikings. All right?
But
he just said that if you take my bread, I slice your throat. Try and run an empire together, James.
But I think there's a love story going on.
Oh my gosh. If this guy, okay.
Come on, she.
Lagerthaand is one of the fan favorites. Okay?
She is.
She's already.
She's my favorite.
She already got fuffled. You guys got that with the queen, king of. Got fuffled with the king of Wessex and Essex, and God knows who else.
She sure did. That dude gets a lot of tail, doesn't he?
He does. He does. Yeah. But we'll get him in season two. Uh-huh. So I'm very reserved with her. I want her to be like, you know.
Really? Oh man. See, I'm the other way around. Like, I love her. I think she can absolutely do no wrong. She can get tail from whoever all ever she wants.
Well, that's why I don't think she should. I think she should be loyal to Ragnar and Ragnar only, because I am.
Well, Ragnar wasn't loyal to her.
That is true.
He might. That might be his.
Move on, you know.
That might be his ride or die girl, but that's no. He's not been loyal to her. He's thrown her out a couple of times in the last couple of seasons, and she just keeps on coming back. And now she's found this dude, who's really cute.
He's good looking though.
He's a good looking guy.
He saved casting, guys.
Saved her life. Right. Excellent casting. He's kind of sly. He's as crafty as she is. And now all of a sudden, he wants to share this with her.
The earldom. Uh-huh. So very, very shocking. And then immediately there, staying with Hedda B, the storyline that we're dissecting right now.
Mm-hmm. Where are we with Hedda B?
With the guy not liking, with Ingvar.
Oh yeah.
Was that am I episode two?
No,
guys, we have papers. We have broken the stuff down.
And we're trying this out. We need your feedback, by the way, if this format is not working, because we got to cram two episodes into one AfterBuzz TV After Show.
No, I'm sorry. I'm taking it back. No, I'm right. Sorry. I've got it right here.
For the first time ever, Yaku's right.
I've got it right
here. I'm going to let you take this one since you're right, Yaku.
So thank you, James.
Yeah,
appreciate
you're welcome.
It.
Yeah, no problem. Anytime.
Yeah, man. Hey, so Ingvar, is that, am I saying it right?
I think so. Yeah, Ingvar. Sounds like a drug I prescribe, but just, anyway.
Yeah, because you are an MP, nurse practitioner. Sorry. We're going to talk. This guy knows all about the medical stuff, so when it comes to the fighting, we're going to have a nice little chat. But not okay with Lagerthaand and Kalf, which is that the good-looking guy's name, joining the Earldom, because he feels like he gave Kalf the Earldom to start with. His family did, and obviously he wants to benefit from it.
Yep.
And he is also in love with Lagerthaand. What
of
an idiot!
Course he is. He was in love with Lagerthaand from
day one.
Well, day one when she got there at the end of season one, I think, right? And then she killed her husband in season two, and he helped her. He was the first one by her side. Of course he was in love with her. So what is he? He challenges the Earl, and he's like, well, my family gave you power. We can take it away from you. So you either are done with your power or you're done with Lagerthaand sharing the earldom with you.
Yeah.
Right? You got it? Break it down.
So it's one of those things where I gave you the bread.
Yeah.
Slice your throat.
Now
I'm
slice
back.
Your throat. I think that's our new euphemism for if you do anything wrong in life, like you stole my bread.
Yeah, so, I like it.
But this scene, Jaco. Man.
Okay, the upcoming scene, James, brace yourself. The upcoming scene. Take us through it.
So everyone in the Earl, the kingdom of Hedda B, gathers around, right? And Ingvar, the guy who really has no power, but his family apparently does, and he helped put Kalf into power.
From where?
All right, randomly, right? They don't explain, but apparently it doesn't matter because this dude is fixing to die. Because he says, look, everybody, if you don't want Lagerthaand to share the earldom, come up and you know, put a notch in the pole.
Put your notch on here, you know, on here.
That's like a comment in YouTube, by the way, which we want to see from you. Put your comments on YouTube if you don't want Lagerthaand to be half Earl or Earl-ish. Or
just what you think in general, or if you would have put a notch into that guy's pole, like Lagerthaand.
Wow.
Which is coming up, James.
Jaco went there.
I went there.
Speaking of notches and poles. So everyone comes up to this pole, they put a notch in the pole, and then, dun-da-da-da, all around them come the
ingenuity, which I can't pronounce, of German, also not right, French ingenuity. All right, there I got it. Crossbow. Done.
Thank you. Boom. They start crossbowing the heck out of everybody, and they all die, including very dramatically. So we ought to start rating the deaths in Vikings, I think, Jaco. I meant to mention this to you guys.
Oh, that's a great idea, James. What do you guys think?
We want you guys to tell us, too, what are your favorite deaths and
how gruesome, how bloody.
Totally.
Oh, my God. A good idea.
Thank you, my friend.
Oh, I love
Give me five.
Yeah.
Give me five.
I love
it. How do you think certain people should die? Like Ingvar, for instance. Ooh, this might be my favorite death so far because this guy's kind of a schmuck.
I'm getting... Is my air standing up? Is that what's happening? Am I just really hot in here?
You're hot thinking about Rollo taking his shirt off.
Okay.
This guy gets an arrow to the neck.
Okay, so first of all, as an MP, straight through the neck. First of all, everybody gets shot down with arrows. Yep. Him and everybody that voted to separate the Earldom from Lagerthaand.
Yep.
Okay, so Kalf is like, sorry, well, this is what I think about it. Bring archers, archers kills everybody.
Down you go.
Great stuff.
Right.
So everybody dies. He gets an arrow through the neck. As an MP, James.
Yes, sir.
Right, this thing looked pretty straight through. You've got your neck cord in the back, the bones and whatever, the throat. What's your dissection there?
I thought this death, I can't believe I'm breaking down the death. I thought this death was fairly realistic in that the arrow going right through the middle would cause him to not be able to talk. It would probably shut down his airway.
But he was able to breathe, though. I heard him breathe.
Well, it would shut down his airway, but not right away. Not right away. He's going to have 30, 45 seconds left of, like, air, there's some in his lungs. Okay, he's gonna like slowly die from that, which was just enough time.
I just wanted to say, James, you beat me to it. 45
you
seconds.
You can have it.
James,
boom.
No, just enough time, James, to do what?
I don't know if I can say it out
loud. Cut off the dick, penis.
He, boom.
The thing hanging from the front. Done.
Slice. And she's like, I should have done this a long time ago. Cut his junk off a long time ago? Like, I know dude was like, not into you, but does that mean you like cut off your
this
junk?
This is Viking world. This is
dude,
how we roll you.
I guess you James. Take the last piece of bread. You are not into. He's just not that into you. Oh, that's cool. I'm gonna cut off his junk. And then she, the best part, she like tosses it.
Yeah, just like
like on the ground, like boop. There you go. Have fun.
So James, that sums up. That I don't think that was fun. To be honest.
No.
But that sums up the Herapy storyline. Yeah, we've got one last storyline that we are going to go, which is the Paris one in episode one. But before we do, all right, guys at home watching the AfterBuzz for Vikings, can you just go into the hosting mode? Yeah, give me a second. Let me just get my seat.
Don't break your chair. Yaku's about to fall off as he's getting into
it. So do I have you guys there on the screen? Have you got
everyone pay attention.
Curious about celebrity boyfriend's midlife crisis? Question mark. Enjoy hearing stories about behind the scenes of Hollywood? Question mark.
Question mark.
Amused by old TV and movie references? Question mark. James.
Question. Oh, sorry. Then you'll love The Tomorrow Show with Kevin Undergaro! Exclamation point. Join AfterBuzz creator and Maria Menounos' fiance. Wasn't that the cutest thing?
Beautiful
I listened
engagement.
On Stern. It was so
beautiful.
Cute.
Love it. Congratulations.
It was so cute. I'm so excited for you guys. Maria Menounos' fiance, Kevin Undergaro, along with AfterBuzz co-hosts Roxy Stryer, Ashley Daniels, and others for all the insanity. Watch live Monday and Thursday nights, 7 to 9 p.m. Pacific time, on thetomorrowshow.com or Jaco.
Yes, I'm listening, James.
Subscribe and download free on iTunes, like you should do with all AfterBuzz TV shows. Go to The Tomorrow Show altogether. TheTomorrowShow.com para más información.
Gracias, muchos.
Mi amigos. So, we'll do a little Spanish. We'll do a little Afrikaans. We will go back
this
to...
This is going
to
be some life language lessons here on the Vikings After Show on AfterBuzz TV. Make sure you guys hashtag ABTV Vikings. Also subscribe, YouTube, and iTunes so you guys can catch us every week.
You got it.
Cool. So let's go to the third storyline here, James. In Paris. Paris. The Eiffel Tower is not present.
Grand Paris.
Grand Paris. Mm-hmm. We start off with Rollo trying to marry... I guess they got it by trying to marry the princess.
I love that this girl. She's a girl. She's a woman. That's what I mean. Sorry, grown woman. She's
French.
I love that she like doesn't care. She doesn't give two. You know what? She is like, nope. This is my stuff. She gives that speech.
She's less miserable. She's there for the French Revolution.
Totally.
She's a proud French.
Yep, and she is so down with her Christianity that even when Rollo takes his shirt off. She's still not down.
Well, that just says tons about her and who she is. Okay, because I don't think a lot of people would have been able to do that.
Oh my! Right? Yes. Once again, how did this has come up three times now? Rollo taking his shirt off.
Oh, okay.
What's my favorite part of the show?
James. All right. So, So first of all, he's in the room there, and so it seems like in this culture, which is also a little bit weird because this is the Christian culture there. They have to, it seems like they have to have sex, Rollo and Gisla, in front of everybody.
How crazy is that? Like, how are you know, we talk about, I was thinking about this. We talk about this with porn stars right now.
Yeah.
Like, that's a gift to be able to, like, do your thing, get hard, have sex, different positions and whatever, while everyone is watching and lights, camera, action. And, but apparently they had to do that back in the day with, like, your minister and the Pope and all these other dudes in the church.
Pope. So the Pope... Are you saying the Pope had to have sex in front of people?
Well, look, he just married... I mean, that guy has to be as powerful as the Pope in France because he just married the king's daughter, right? Like, you get the highest Christian dude in the land to do the highest wedding in the land. And he's standing there and he's about to watch the consummation of the marriage, which does come into play a little bit later on. But Rollo says, no, I might be a backstabbing bastard... But I am
no woman raper in front of people.
Correct. I am not going to do this in front of all y'all. Get out. Now, why does he... Why do you think...
He's just got respect for... Like, he says, okay...
Do you think it's respect?
I don't think it's respect, sorry. I think it's just common sense.
Rollo doesn't have any respect.
I just think it's common sense. The girl doesn't want him. He's not going to win her over like this, so let's go to plan B and try to win over this way. You out, everybody, let's get out. All right, so now they're on the bed, James.
Well, you went to a place, Jaco.
I did go to
a place. Before we go to bed, you went to a place that I didn't go. Maybe you guys did, and I totally missed this, but that maybe this was, like, strategic.
Yeah, maybe.
Like, maybe he was like, I'm really going to win her over because I need her. He's not just going to, like, Vikings his way through this, which he could have very easily.
Very easily.
He could have just slit her neck.
Yeah.
With a big axe.
She didn't take any bread, though, so.
It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
She wasn't about to consummate the marriage, so he could have done that. But no, instead, she, like, pulls out the knife, and they have this whole scene on the bed, and she's like, I will cut you.
I will cut you, boy.
And right. You went Deliverance on me. And he's like, stop, you're tickling me.
He's falling asleep while she's like trying to slice his skin open.
And she's like, no, you did not just fall asleep on me. And he's like, oh, whatever, I'm not worried about you. But that was a moment. It really was with those two that kind of sets up the future.
Definitely might have won a grain of respect there from him for not forcing himself on her and, you know, doing what they want to do. So
did they bait us with that? Did they bait us in? They were like, yeah, we want you to respect Rollo just a little bit. For about 30 minutes.
Yeah, until Herrick shows up. Herrick is his friend, his comrade, that's living outside on the few leftover Vikings that's in Paris that's supposed to maintain their ground there. Herrick is the leader there. He sees Rollo.
Right.
Yep.
And, well, yeah, he comes in to tell Rollo. He's like, look, man, half this camp is not down with what you're doing. I know we're here, and I know we made this agreement, and et cetera, but they're not cool with you marrying the princess,
Princess. Exactly, she's a princess, so that makes him now a nobleman, right?
Not having it.
And so the big problem here, James, is I am a Viking. I do not fight for a nobleman. I fight for
the gods.
No, Ragnar Lothbrok. Ragnar, which is above the gods.
Who is very good, Jaco.
Thank you.
Yes, he is. So these guys. Well, Eric comes to tell them, and Rollo's like, "Who are?" Are you also one of these people who doesn't agree with what I'm doing? And he's like, no, I got your back for life. And Rollo's like, okay, cool. Go ahead and go back and tell everybody. I'll come see them soon to ease their minds.
I'm going to ease their minds permanently.
Permanently. And we're all like, cool. Rollo's going to go like hang out with his homeboys again.
He just fought, like, no big deal. He just fought with Ragnar. Somewhat of a victory. Got a lot of gold and stuff from Paris. Alongside those people, I mean, it's maybe weeks at this point, maybe a month, maybe two, three, 4 months, whatever. Yeah,
it's hard to tell.
I mean, just like that brings us to the last closing scene of this episode. epic stuff going down, okay?
Okay, why do they keep doing this to us? We should know this by now. We should come to expect this. But they do this, like every other episode, that like breaks your heart. I can't handle it. Because Rollo comes and
they're playing on your heartstrings, James.
They are, because I'm apparently a nice guy or something.
Yeah.
And Rollo comes to the camp and is like, hey guys, I'm here to talk. I understand you have some issues. Well, he doesn't say all that, but he's trying to say it with his face, right? He like rolls up in his new Parisian you know, robe or whatever and his pretty Parisian horse.
No. I think that's before the makeover. It comes.
Well, not the makeover, but he's still prettier now. He's not at least like Vikings dirty.
That's very true. Okay, I give it.
And
yeah,
he like
sure.
rolls up, and they're like, "Hey, Rollo, you're here. Open the gates. Come in." And Rollo just like stands there.
He doesn't say anything. Very. Nope. He's got that, almost a smirk on his face.
Doesn't he?
Yeah, so that happens, and then now everybody, including you and me and James here, uh-huh. are sitting and watching while we're waiting what's going to happen. And the play of Header B with the crossbows comes into mind, and believe it or not, there it is.
More crossbows.
Like ants, crossbows coming over the side, and it's a slaughter, man. These guys are just, oh my God, and those arrows are so big and thick.
Aren't they?
It's like
super crazy.
You think it's like thin and streamlined. No, it's like tree trunks.
And they get every time someone gets hit, you know, it makes that noise on TV, like, oh, right. Well, yeah, it probably does, because it's like half a redwood going through you every time someone fires you with one of those crossbows. Those damn French, they're as mean as the Vikings are.
If not meaner.
If not meaner.
No, okay, no, let's not step on toes yet.
No, that's true, right. We should be like legit with
this. So the Herrick, the guy that went to see, you know, Ragnar, he's forming a shield wall, and he's trying to defend himself. It's just too many French, the freaking French, everywhere.
French.
And you know, he's trying to form a shield wall, decide, okay, well, they're going to storm at least the guards at the gate, or at least Rollo.
No.
They don't even make it to him, James.
No, of course not, because. Well, there's way too many crossbows and way too few shields and way too few Vikings, and they all—it's like they're just walking through, and he's picking each of them off just a little bit. And Eric, at the end,
in it all,
finally, last guy, he like as he's dying, arrow sticking out of him, he's like, "Ragnar will avenge us," which could not be more true.
Exactly.
I'm jumping ahead, but it's my first prediction.
Well, prediction, we'll do the predictions for episode 3.
That one's pretty easy.
Yeah. So, because our prediction is what we're going to talk now is totally. Episode 2, which is a great segue to episode 2. So
we're done with episode 1.
Yeah, let's put that one down there. Ground. It's all done.
Peace out.
Let's go to episode 2. The episode 2's name is Kill the Queen.
Kill the Queen.
And not a lot.
I get it now, by the way. I didn't understand the name of the episode.
Enlighten us.
Until the end of the episode.
Kill the Queen.
Because sometimes I'm a little slow. Because they only say kill the queen about 47,000 times at the end of the episode.
Okay.
We'll get there in a minute.
We'll get there in a
minute. Kill the queen.
Thank you, James. You enlightened me because I did not put two and two together.
I am not the only one.
No, you're not.
You guys probably put it together. You guys are smart.
You guys are smart.
Who are these guys reviewing this show?
Are we watching this shame show?
Correct.
What's going on?
Kill the
queen. We've got your back. Don't worry. Okay, we got your back.
We got your back.
James, we start off in Paris. Mm-hmm. Episode 2, season 4, Vikings. #ABTV Vikings.
Yes.
Beautiful city. It's a pan over the city of France. No Eiffel Tower, once again. A little bit disappointed because it's only like 1,000 years early.
I was going to say, didn't the Eiffel Tower was a gift back in 1790?
Something like
1860. Somebody correct me, please. Tell me when the Eiffel Tower was
Please
put
throw
up.
It anyway. Out there.
Yeah.
And the beautiful city, you've got the river going around the city.
Mm-hmm.
It sets up the scene where Rollo is talking to the main guard, the defender of Paris, about how to stop the Vikings when they attack again. Because everybody knows they're coming back, James. Guys.
Of course. Yep, of course they are. I thought this was really interesting because, Jaco, sometimes they don't necessarily convey very well that they're not actually speaking each other's language. But in this scene, they did a really good job of
very
that.
Very good.
So that the big fat Earl guy, now he's not an Earl, he's a Count. The Count guy with the long hair. He is sort of translating, but Rollo's like, here's the book. Good. And he like hits the guy, and they like war planning. It's like we're playing G.I. Joes back when we're kids or something. But it ends up sounding like it might actually be a fairly decent plan.
So the plan is Survivor, which is my other show that I do. Sorry, wrong show.
Plug.
Vikings. Plug. Watch us Wednesday night
we'll just
for Survivor.
Play it off as a plug. Right,
for the Vikings. Vikings. Fans.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the plan. The Vikings attack on the river leading up to Paris.
Mm-hmm.
So Rollo's idea is building two forts. Now the main guy's asking, well, how Are they going to, if they, well, the forts is going to, you know, stop them. How are they going to, they're going to get past the forts? How do you stop that?
Rollo's like, nope, I got it. I'm going to put my necklace across the river.
Chain, a metal chain, you sink it into the water, and then on one end, as the boats come closer, they won't see the chain, lift up the chain, and either physically stop the boats or behead everybody.
Ooh.
No, the boats don't go fast enough.
I didn't
enough.
Think
the
about
beheading.
The
boats don't go fast enough.
How cool
chains.
Would that be if they did, though?
They
like,
did, no,
everyone
please.
Slowly gets...
I'm literally writing the season as we... They probably, hopefully, hasn't happened yet, okay? Because this is only episode 2.
Because we're only talking about episode 2. You guys still with us, by the way? Hashtag ABTV Vikings. We're talking about episode 2 right now.
Yep.
Someone needs to tell us about the Eiffel Tower. What else do we need? We need some help with. Well, we need a lot of help.
We need a lot of help. So make sure you guys, you know, catch us live on our next one on Thursday night. It's going to be 11 o'clock.
Yeah.
Woo. Catch us live. It's going to be for the next few months because we're going to be doing all the seasons.
Because we got to catch up. A lot of Vikings to talk about.
So we're still in Paris.
Yep.
And now, so that's the one thing, the whole trap thing and the show. Yep. The next scene in Paris is Rollo getting Frenched.
Yes. Well, in between, don't forget, big ugly count guy. I shouldn't judge people by how they look, but this is how the Vikings roll. Big ugly count guy has that lady that he's like seducing, and she comes to play later on, and he pulls out the riding crop, and he's like, this one's bigger than last time, and it's going to hurt you more.
I'm so confused and lost right now.
Do you remember he's talking to the lady?
I remember him talking, but I didn't see that
well,
be that.
Well,
cuz
we don't really know a lot
what the hell did he pull
lady.
Out?
A riding crop that you whip horses with, Jaco. Like a
oh,
like
and
like
that's
smack.
Why she had this.
That's why
she
had
the stuff.
Gross,
glad
right?
We watched the same
well, maybe
episode.
Not gross. I mean, some people are into that stuff. If you into some freaky stuff. No, I'm saying, everybody's got their freaky freak. But she apparently is willing to go so freaky freak in order to get the information from the count for the other dude. But we'll get that in a minute. Okay. So he gets freaky with her, the riding crop. Ouch. And then we go to Rollo's completely ridiculous.
It's like haircut. He's like blowing the hair out of his face. It's nice and cold. I think
like
the tips are cold.
Mani-pedi. He's like, my hair is dead. He's in Beverly Hills getting like a makeover.
And he's got his nice little robes, beautiful
white.
He
does, and his hair's all like poofed out.
He might have even taken a shower or a bath.
I think he did. He can smell. That's all right. I'm cool with that. Yeah, I said that.
Oh, good silence.
But then, no. Silence is okay. But then his wife...
He looks ridiculous. First of all, he looks ridiculous. Right. And he feels ridiculous. You can see it. And obviously, right now, James, he's obviously doing... Why? Seeking approval? Why?
Well...
Why?
I'm a little crushed by this because I think he is seeking approval from Lady Gessler? Gessler.
But let's talk about this real quick. Isn't that an amazing and dramatic flip for you from murdering Viking, taking over, going for a reason to plummet Paris, to killing his own people, wanting to marry this person, and then, but not just that, that's all okay still because it's just you get money and land.
Right,
but
right.
Now trying to impress this woman.
And
why?
He looks actually defeated when she laughs at him.
So that begs the question. Does he love her? Is he actually really... He didn't have sex with her in the beginning. He didn't want to force himself upon her.
Uh-huh.
He's trying to impress her. Does he actually love this woman?
Does he love her? Is he scheming? Is he thinking about all the ways he did...
How he can
Siggy
blindside
wrong?
Her? Maybe he can...
Yep.
Anyway, she comes in, she laughs it off. So that's about the whole story there.
She laughs it off. And he actually looks hurt. Like a little bit actually hurt. Poor guy. No, not poor Rollo.
He killed like 60 people.
Right,
so.
Of his own.
Yeah.
But we can fast forward to now this thing we were talking about with the riding crop. And I am so sorry that I don't know her name. But she, the lady that's sleeping with the big count guy.
Yeah, we don't have her name.
Sleeps with the other French dignitary. Who was strategizing with Rollo in the beginning. You with me?
Okay.
She's sleeping with both of those French guys and trading their information back and forth? Or just taking information from the count
to the
other guy with the beard?
I think so.
Who is tending her wounds after she has been whooped mercilessly.
She has been whooped good. Ouch.
With the riding prop. Mm-hmm. Man, I did. They were kinky in like the 12th, we're in the 12th century, right? 13th century? Wow.
Goodness.
Yikes. Well,
I'm trying to think of a segue of century for that, but I mean, that's... She's been whipped for a century.
Whipped
for a century. She's been whipped by a century. like for a centurion, like I don't know.
That's, but I think that's it in Paris.
Like, yeah, that's it in Paris. Let's jump over.
Have anybody else?
Let's jump over to England, James.
Yeah.
For
let's
and
do it.
So. This didn't come into the first episode to play. Right now we're back in Wessex with King Egbert. This guy had a huge Egbert. King one down in Essex with King Egbert, and we're gonna see what the English are all up to. Got a horrible English accent.
You just went through like four accents right there. You didn't even start off.
I'll just do myself African English. Accent for this thing.
There you can. There you can. There you
I
go.
Can. There you go.
You can, right. I'm mixing
but
my
James,
words.
This is this didn't come in play in the first episode, but a huge part of the third season. So take us through this. Mercia is being overthrown.
Right. Well, the king's son comes in. He's got some great information about
oh,
the Mercia.
Oh, there's my English accent.
There's my English accent. Right. He's like, the Mercia has been overthrown by those evil heathen pagans.
Pagans, you pagan!
And so he's like, well, what are we going to do about this, Daddy?
Daddy, it's so hot outside, Daddy. It's so hot outside, I don't know what to do about these pagans.
We've got to do something about the pagans. And
get
they
the whip,
are,
let's whip them.
Let's whip them.
Is that what we're doing, that
with
English
a riding
whip?
Crop?
With any English fans out there, we're sorry.
Sorry,
we're
totally. And they actually don't even talk like that in the episode.
Yeah, well, they do. I'm kidding.
Just a little. Come on. So, Mercia, right? We're kind of going back to season three a little bit because they don't really do much Wessex in episode one of season four. So, we're going back to season three. Remember, Mercia is helping out, where are we? Wessex, with this, you know, deal, and it's Queen Quinrith.
Quinrith.
She apparently has been overthrown by the mercenaries who were helping her fight against the Vikings.
Those
in the first
guys
place.
Look English, though. So it might be the countrymen as well for Mercia.
I
so
agree.
Mercia, she's overthrown. She's the queen. And now they want the nobleman there doesn't want to pay homage to King Egbert anymore.
Nope.
They want their country back. They imprison her in the tower, almost like Goldilocks or...
And you wonder right thingy. Away, though, Jaco. You
yes.
wonder right away. What... role does King Egbert play in this? Because I think he plays a role. I don't think King Egbert has been playing both sides. Remember, he backstabbed the other guy in season two, and he's been playing Queen Quinrith. He's been playing everybody, sleeping with Lagerthaand.
Yeah, I mean,
like this guy.
This guy's a player. If you ever seen one, you won't want to let this guy loose in Vegas.
I think they're setting him up to be like on par with Ragnar here because the dude has a ton of power.
And he's clever.
Very, very clever. He's
and
got
he
this
thinks
son.
Of all angles.
Yeah, he can sort of send his son out to do his crazy bidding, if you will. And so right away, you know, the son is like, oh, you know, what's his name? Ethelwulf?
Ethelwulf.
Comes in and is like, oh, the mercenaries have taken over in Mercia. And King Egbert's like, oh, my goodness, really? That's crazy. What should we do about
it? What should we do about it?
And you wonder right away, King Egbert, you had something to do with this, didn't you? I don't trust your butt.
And we'll see what happens. It's going to come out in the later episodes.
Yeah.
So, well, where are we at? So these guys are raising an army. They decide it's important to raise an army because they want Mercia back. He wants the lands, the wealth that comes with it.
Very important.
So it looks like Ethelwulf or... Ethelwulf is almost like Beowulf is taking Beowulf. Most of his Beowulf taking most of his good warriors and heading out to go get it back, rescue the queen, Queen Quinrith, and that's about it.
Well, because they send we can't pass this up. Do you remember they send out boxes full of those people's heads from
the
Mercia?
Scouts, the people that scouted out what's going on in Mercia.
Right.
So the one scout comes back. They question him and they say that Quinrith is in this tower.
Egbert's like, can you believe this messenger that says she's in the tower? And Ethelwulf, his son, is like, yes, I believe him. We're going to go. And the king's like, all right, cool, bye. While you're gone, getting our other lands back and defending our ally, I'm going to talk to your wife.
Yeah, Judith.
About coming in and learning the sacred texts, which is coincidentally... versus ironic. Coincidentally, what Aethelstan
was doing
for Egbert, and she used to love Aethelstan.
She liked him a lot. She liked him a lot, James.
I liked him a lot too.
Yeah,
we
I liked him a lot
him.
Too.
He was like the good dude.
Maybe he's not even dead.
Is
Maybe he'll come
dead?
Back.
Right. That's what we.
So she
know.
Tells him she wants to pay. You know.
Oh yeah.
She tells him she wants to pay. He's like, I'll do it. She thinks he's joking. Like, you won't really let me pay because women aren't allowed to learn or work in the religion, yeah,
yeah.
It's West women's rights back in the day.
They were really progressive.
West Joan of Arc, French. Mm,
correct.
So we're all wondering, James, why is King Egbert helping Judith to accomplish this writing test? Because he's getting in the monk.
Right, and so there's this whole interplay, and it's not the most compelling storyline at this juncture, so we can kind of speed through it, I think, but she's,
yes,
you know, please. He's, the whole time we're watching, Yaku's like, what is this? What, I don't care. But can he says, all right, I'm gonna teach you, and then he sends in her into the monk, whose name is Proteus, Portentous.
Oh. I thought it was a great name.
Portentous, right. Is he pretentious? Pretentious? Portentous.
It's a porcupine.
And it's like, well, I can't teach you because you're a woman. And then they go to this other guy who's like some church dude who we've never met. And the church dude tells Portentous and the king, like, nope, you got to teach this woman because Jesus Christ let a prostitute wash his feet and he's the son of God and whatever. All right, so fine. Judith's learning the secret texts.
Which begs the question, secret text, why?
Right.
What do you think?
I think Egbert's up to something.
Okay, so that's not an answer at all. Thanks, James. I'm just going
right. to... Because of course he's up to something, right?
I'm not going
to...
Yeah. shit, Sherlock. Right. I'm just going to be honest and say I have no idea. I have no idea. I'm just going to leave it up to the episode to come to overwhelm me with your writers, and let us know why.
They will, because they're very, very good and very talented, and they've gotten much better as the seasons have gone along. Yeah. You guys are awesome. So... No, we don't know what's going on, and we probably at this point don't care. I feel like they're setting us up for like season 7 with whatever. Because it's
hopefully, because you'll see a lot of us.
Right? Oh my.
Maybe,
for
I don't know.
7 seasons, that's right. So are we done with Wessex?
No, we're not, because now it comes into the epic part. Yeah. It's going to come into actually saving Queen Gwynryth. We'll get these names down for you guys, problem.
If you guys have
just give us a chance here.
If you guys have some mnemonics that can help us with the names.
If like, somebody can explain to me what a mnemonic is, that will also be helpful.
Oh, Jaco.
Not you. Never mind. That's
you
fine.
Guys tell us what a mnemonic is. Yeah. You guys, in the comments, tell Jaco what a mnemonic is. I can say it. And give us some mnemonics for these people's names. Queen Q. How about we call her Queen Q?
Queen Q is in the tower. Yeah. She's it's like the long hair. Like I'm trying to do the three... Goldilocks and the Three Bears, like out of the tower. Doesn't matter. Right. No, yeah, I digress. I'm sorry.
Uh-huh.
Nothing to do with anything. But she's in the tower, up in the top, and she is waiting. She's got two people with her. She's got two maidens with her, which against her, they're looking after her. Right. And we missed something very important, guys. She's got a kid with her, which King Egbert asks, make sure you guys save the kid.
Save the
James?
Kid. That's right. Whoa, Jaco.
James?
He said that. Save the kid. Save Marcus. Magnus.
Why?
Why did he send Judith to the secret text? I'm telling you, Egbert is kind of a baller. I think he's up to some stuff.
Here I actually think that might be his kid.
Oh, Gwynryth.
Yeah.
Well,
they were going at it
totally
like hard in season 3.
Totally.
All the time. So that might be his kid.
That's the easy answer for sure.
Yeah,
does Vikings ever do anything easy?
Yeah, fair enough.
No.
Fair enough.
They were shagging quite a bit there.
Yeah,
for
they
like
were.
2 seasons.
They
yeah.
were going at it. What's happening here?
So this battle scene is really it's really fun. Jaco, you made a really good point about this. It was a very open battle scene. It was very like...
Not mass amounts of people.
Right. Very disjointed. Like there were these little groups here and this little group here and someone was at the tower.
A few people fighting here. A few people. One archer there. The other archer there.
It was very different than some other... Well, all of these... This is part of the reason we watched the show, right? For these epic battle scenes where like 40,000 people die and there's axes and blood.
Blood.
Madness everywhere. This one was sort of like, there's 7 people with their shields and they're like, don't kill me. And I got the 4 people on this side. It's got like an arrow across. And then you've got one
archers.
Guy running across the field and one guy throwing a stone.
Okay, so the point here, James. Mm-hmm. Very surprised in the beginning here that people are storming the castle. They're saying, halt, stop, whatever you're doing. And it's 2 people on their horses. They're driving there to hook the doors. Now, there's 3 or 4 or 5 archers on the top shooting at them. And looking at the shooting in the previous episode, it's pretty accurate. But these French crossbows are good. Or maybe that's what it is.
Huge
arrow
things.
But they miss the horses and the horsemen.
And the horsemen then pull the doors off and then ride away with the door. And they still don't get arrowed. At least we don't see them get arrowed.
No.
That's right, because what does end up happening is this kind of fun battle scene, right? Very Vikings-esque, there's people dying and whatever, but the what it builds to are the two best parts, that's four, two best parts, which are Queen Q whooping some ass in the tower.
We'll get there, hold on.
Aren't we there yet? Because everyone says this is the name of the episode. See, this is where it finally comes in.
Well, this is why. This is why. The gates are open. So we're talking about this disjointed fighting scene. And Beowulf, or Awolf, like other people like to call him, are coming from the blindsiding the attack and from the side in this archers. But the main guy that's in opposition from Mercia is now realizing that he's seeing he's getting flanked. He's seeing people are straight coming from him in the front. Mm-hmm. And he yells at this point, kill the queen.
Kill the queen. Hence the name of the episode. Dun,
thanks, dun, James. Oh, I love our engineer. We're going to get some better sounds and next sounds. We're going to have so much fun in coming
Steve,
episodes.
Steve, don't you... That sound is perfectly lovely. You don't... You,
no, no.
Yaku's,
hey, that, I'm just saying we can do other sounds in coming episodes. Correct. Maybe we can get like a fart noise.
Nope.
Hey!
Oh, there it is. Fart noise. We, you know what we need to get? Like someone dying with an axe. When we go through and like we dissect like, the murders.
How does it sound when a sword penetrates the human body? Gross. That's the noise that you need to get for us in the next episode.
We're clearly used to it. So wait, we'll go back to this scene you're talking about. Because this is great. Because everyone is dying.
The Matrix.
And the guys, the mercenaries in Mercia who are holding Queen Q captive, right? You with me? Are like, kill the queen, kill the queen. And everyone's screaming, kill the king, kill the queen. So Beowulf, since we can't pronounce his name, Ethelwulf, is like, I have to save the queen
History
by myself.
History Channel is going
to
kill us.
Right, they are. They're like, you guys get the damn names right. So Ethelwulf heads towards the tower, and there's one badass soldier dude who is defending the tower, right? And he is like, I'm not going to let you in. And this is one of the first times that I have seen a really, really good hand-to-hand fight on this show that didn't involve like a quick knife.
Yes.
Or an axe.
A lot of effort going into
totally. It was awesome. Rocks falling from the tower.
So this
tower.
Is if we were fighting the soldier, and the soldier puts up a good fight.
Really good fight.
So, so this is outside.
Outside,
right? The guy's got the key, can get in.
Outside the tower.
Yeah, outside
They're
the
fighting
tower.
Fighting over the key.
Meanwhile, on the inside, the top of the tower, Queen Q is manhandling the two maidens that's there.
And if you didn't love her before this for all her wackiness.
She is crazy times. She's some kind of crazy.
That's a song. Some kind of wonderful. She's some kind of crazy. And she takes these two chicks on. It is badass. It's awesome. I think because it's the whole mom thing, right?
Okay.
She's like, I'm protecting my child.
So now I'm going to interstate with the mom thing here, James.
Yeah.
We've got a comment here on the live chat. Thanks for joining us. It is from Humto. Thanks so much for commenting. And he said that Queen Q's son is Ragnar's son.
What?
So thanks for commenting. We appreciate it. You are here with us live watching.
How did we miss that?
Appreciate it. And so that's the deal there. I'm going to fact check that. I'm going to tell you.
I know. We need... All right. We want to know what you guys
you
think.
You probably are right.
We want to know what you guys think. Is it Ragnar's son or is it King
Look,
Ekbert's
we haven't
son?
Been watching season 3 for a year now. So,
right.
You know, it's okay. We'll get
we
back.
Could, we could be
we could
a little
be
bit behind.
We could
right.
be wrong. Very so let's get back. So the mother is trying in the tower. She is trying to defend the son. And there's the beating with a plank and there's hitting heads against rocks and...
It's kind of awesome. I mean, it's great.
It's cool.
It is
it's
cool.
Great.
And
it's like she does not give up, and I got goosebumps just looking at the scene and fighting.
Her being so like
I would be the protected. Same way. I felt I relate. I would be the same. I will not give up.
And why should you? That right? Isn't this why we watch this show? Really awesome fight scenes. Really great.
But this
bloody,
James,
gory
you
stuff.
Called it. The gory stuff is epic, and that's great. But these two scenes between Queen Q and Awolf was amazing because they just put so much fighting
like,
into it.
Hand
Good
to
job,
hand.
History Channel.
Yes.
Thumbs
Excellent
up.
Job. This hand-to-hand combat. And you almost, because she's a little bit crazy and you ultimately want the Vikings to win, right? But you end up cheering for Queen Q. You're like, no, save the queen. And let Ethelwulf rescue her so they can go back to, wait, Wessex and King Ecgbert. Shoot, I'm not supposed to be cheering for these people. Damn it!
But you do because the fighting is so good. Because
it's so awesome. So, but then Ethelwulf does finally come in.
And saves the day.
Queen Q is almost about to die. She's getting choked. Ethelwulf comes in.
Reaching out for a kid. Ragnar's son, apparently. Hopefully.
No way. There's no way. Ragnar's son.
Because he did. I remember because Lagerthaand was King Ecgbert and Ragnar was with her.
Which makes sense. So who knows whose kid it is? Next episode should be called Baby Daddy?
So Travis over here, Barzi is saying that the baby daddy is in fact Ragnar, Ragnar's son, but he is not as famous as the older sons, of course. So this son is, Ragnar has got kids all over the planet now at this point. He's like an international traveler, the world.
Papa was next a rolling one, stone. Right.
So the next one is going to be in Paris, hopefully, so we'll see. But anyway, so we finish off the storyline here with Wessex where it's saving Queen Q with the knife,
right?
And and that kind of ends up the whole thing.
That's the end of the episode.
No, we still got Bjorn and Kattegat.
Just kidding.
So really quick, we're gonna go into Bjorn. He in the previous season said he's leaving. This guy is he's snow tracking. Ain't got no snow hounds or nothing with him.
Jaco, I'm gonna wrap Bjorn up in about 10 seconds for you.
Yeah, go.
He's still alive.
That's fishing, and he's got to go.
That's all we need to know.
Let's get back to Kattegat.
So, this is the hunt for Floki.
Yeah. Also pretty fast. Uh-huh. Floki escapes. Okay. First off, my point of view, James, was Ragnar helped him because I have that feeling he's not going to do anything to him. He can't.
Nope.
It's Floki built his first ship for him when they went and sailed to the east, you know?
Floki backstabbed
or the west.
King
or the
Herrick in season west. 2. Like, Floki's been, questions Ragnar, challenges Ragnar, but ultimately has always had Ragnar's back, and Ragnar knows that. And he's like, you know what, Jaco? Everybody has this friend. You always have this one friend, right? You're like, this dude is crazy.
Yeah.
I can't believe this dude is still
he
in my life.
He challenges me, but he's always got my back. He always sits next to you in prison.
Right. He's like getting arrested with you. Like, everybody has that person, and the writers have done a beautiful job in making Floki not only appropriately crazy, but Ragnar's dude.
The mascara is not helping.
No.
So, yeah. That's
and it's all over.
It's all over. Like,
you
this
should
guy
wear
got,
mascara.
Can we do that on the show? Do you guys want us to be a little bit more Viking-ish? Because we'll start drinking beer and put mascara on.
I'm trying
as well. It's not getting very far.
I'm going to get my Vikings. And this is not going to be water next time. It's going to be ale.
We'll do it. We'll do it, James.
Yeah.
So we didn't cut the gut. Floki escaped. Ragnar goes to Helga real quick. Did you help him escape? Takes her some food, James. Did you help escape? She's like, she doesn't even know, but she thinks so. She obviously did, because Ragnar wouldn't ask if he didn't do it.
I don't think so.
Okay, fair enough.
I think he's playing games with
Helga. I'm just asking the question so you can explain it.
You're right. He's asking questions. Or he's playing with Helga. He's playing with everybody. Ragnar plays with everybody. He's the ultimate player, figuratively and literally.
Yeah. He's got kids over the world.
Right, because Helga's like, I don't know. I think I helped him. Maybe, like,
that's a very good point. So she's not like, yes. At this point, she doesn't know what she's doing. She's sleep deprived. The kid is sick. You don't know what's going on.
Totally, right.
So, yes, are we going to stand with that Ragnar set him free?
Totally. Where that is.
Oh, James.
Staunch.
Get us here on the camera. There you go.
Boom.
There you go. Boom. If you're on iTunes, this is just high fiving because this is how good the season is.
It is that good, man. But then it gets a little sad.
Yeah, okay. So Floki is running. It's over mountains. It's in the snowy passes, rivers. And unrealistic for me a little bit. I think Floki is a little bit more agilitized. It's got a little
that
more...
That is a word.
Enough in my language it is.
In English. We taught you Afrikaans, Spanish, and now English. Agilitized.
He's agilitized.
Agilitized, right.
So, and he would make it over those rocks pretty much faster than I thought he would, but...
You're right, because we've been watching this episode for like 40 minutes at this point, and all of a sudden you look like Floki turns around and he's like, oh, they're still there!
And
like,
it's not just men, James, it's the 12-year-old kid!
The 10-year-old.
That needs to be in bed by 10,
correct,
right?
And he's like, no, he's not on the hill where all of you intelligent adults who have been trained and practiced in tracking people are. No, I think he's in the water over here.
Yeah.
Just on a hunch. Maybe okay, because well, he's the, Ragnar's child.
Yeah, I wanted to say it, James. Sorry. We all were thinking it. We all were thinking it. He's Ragnar's baby boy, so this guy's got some brains.
Okay? Does he?
Yeah.
Or he's touched by the gods.
He's touched by the gods, maybe. Regardless, he finds Floki. Floki's fighting. I can't believe it. I wish he was going to get away. But once again, it's Vikings. He got caught, dragged all the way back to Kattegat. Which, can I just say this, Afrikaans, another word, guys? Okay. Kattegat's how you guys say it. In Afrikaans, it literally means cat's asshole.
Kattegat. Means cat's asshole.
Cat's asshole.
I wonder if the writers knew this.
Not probably a real place in the Viking. I mean, I don't. Maybe we'll do some fact checking as to how accurate Vikings
well, because
is.
You said right. I'm gonna educate you guys and enlighten you a little bit. Are you ready? Yeah. So Jaco told me earlier that Afrikaans is a lot like Dutch, which is probably it's a Nordic language, right? It's Northern Europe.
Yeah.
So it has its roots in.
We're not going to stream this from Afrikaans all the way
we
to
are.
Cat's asshole.
I'm doing it. Cat's asshole. Right.
Oh, God.
Right. I won't go all the way there. You guys follow me. You see what I'm saying.
We'll definitely get some research on with what the deal is, with where that is, and how. And we'll get it down for you guys so we can all be Viking fans together.
Word.
So, James, where we at? So we're back in Kattegat.
We're back in Kattegat. Floki has been captured. He's brought back. Everyone's excited because he was everyone's homeboy, like, you know, 10 days ago, and then all of a sudden he's, like, everyone's enemy. Okay, I guess I buy that. And then they presented right in front of Ragnar. And Ragnar has to make this grandstand. He has to, like, say something.
He has to.
Yeah, in front of everybody.
But he's giving him an opportunity to say, you son of Valhalla. Okay?
Perfect.
Odin's mother. Odin's mother, can you just say that you killed Athelstan and that you did it because you were jealous? Or not because it's anything but
something.
That the gods told you to do it.
Right.
But no, Floki doesn't.
And because he's, and he can't. Maybe he can't because that's what, I think that would be a character flaw in Floki if Floki did back off. I think they've been setting Floki up for 3.5 seasons now or 3 seasons and 2 episodes. And I think if Floki all of a sudden was like, yeah, Ragnar, I feel you. I did it because I'm jealous. Nudge, nudge, wink, wink. I would totally not buy anything else Floki did. So I love you writers. Thank you. For staying true to who Floki's character is, and he basically was like, screw y'all. Yep, the gods told me, and I would do it again. Doesn't he say that?
I would do it again.
I would do it again.
If I could do it over. And Ragnar, take him away. I'm going to get you a punishment that is going to hurt so much, just as much as Athelstan's death hurt me.
Hurt you.
And so, and that means to me that he's not going to kill Floki, and he looks at Helga, Floki's wife. So now I'm thinking he's either going to kill Helga. Always gonna kill the kid.
Oh my god, and we're all
but
like,
Ragnar wouldn't do that because he took them food.
Right.
You know? Okay, so whatever.
But then was he setting him up with the food? I don't know.
Maybe. These Viking writers, History Channel, these guys are messing with our minds.
They are good.
Alright, so we're now Ragnar is furious. He's in his little hut with his queen with his queen Aslaug. And he's saying, listen, why can't he just admit to it? You know, he's angry. And then Queen Aslaug,
she's like, well, maybe he did the right thing.
Because he did, apparently. Because what did he do, James?
Killed Athelstan because the gods told him to.
No, James. Yes. Well, yes, James. As a Viking.
No, James. Yes, James.
Yes, James. That is what he did. But as a Viking, he killed a Christian. So you tell me right now, what is wrong with that?
Thank you. Nothing. Queen Aslaug says nothing's wrong with that. Why should you punish Floki? Because there's absolutely nothing wrong with what he did. And I gotta practice it. Ragnar did this like soap opera dramatic turnaround. It was great. I hope Travis Fimmel had to practice this for like hours. He was like dramatic. And then proceeds to slapping her.
Twice.
Boom, boom. Down boom. She goes. Because he's like, you can't. No, that's not what this is about. This is not about. He's like, religion aside, that's not what this is about.
This is not about the gods. This is not about killing a Christian.
Wait, we got to say this. What does he say? We got to get this one right. He says, it's about loyalty
and
trust.
Trust.
Something you can't understand. Ooh.
Ouch. You know?
Double
thanks
ouch.
For slapping me twice and then stabbing a stake through my heart.
Because,
you know?
And he was like, you can't understand that, which is. So then, all right, that's telling us, duh, Ragnar clearly knows.
He's over her.
Well, he's not only is he over her, but he knows in some super secret subconscious way that Queen Aslaug has been like plotting behind his back.
Yeah, because she's I'm not gonna say it online. Maybe in the next few episodes, because we're not raw Vikings just yet. But she's a bee.
She's a bee, right? When we earn the Vikings title, we can say those words out loud, that we can swear. Although there's been a few asses dropped tonight.
Yeah, for sure.
But remember, she's talking to the seer in the beginning of episode one.
Yeah.
Did we forget that part? And she's asking the seer, you know,
who's going to be queen
or whatever. That's right. We did talk about that. And then all of a sudden, fast forward, Ragnar's like, you don't understand trust and loyalty. Huge moment, huge scene. I think she goes down very soon.
Okay, I like that. I think so too. I think the time is running out. The episode ends off with Helga digging a grave, which is Floki's wife. Ragnar once again making it out all the way there. And what are you doing? You know?
So sad. And she's digging a grave and he's like, who are you digging a grave for? My daughter, how did she die? Does it matter?
She's dead.
She's dead. And interestingly, I thought this was going to be the punishment.
Well, that's what I'm saying. But so is it set up where when he looked at Helga or the kid, knowing that Floki can provide for the kid and that she was sick, that he will die, and that's going to make Floki hurt? Because he also asks her, James, guys at home, he also asks her, does Floki know about this?
Right, and she's like, no. So did Ragnar kill the daughter, which was his intention, but did he do it indirectly by tying... Very Christian-like, by the way, if you notice this, tying Floki up in a cave and waterboarding his butt for who knows how long, like basically naked. Who knew Floki had abs, by the way?
Yeah.
But he puts Floki up and his arms are up and he looks like Christ on the cross.
Yeah.
Lots of Christian symbolism here. And then waterboard, or
and he's close to waterboarding. As his kid is dying or being buried, he's yelling and it's just... That you're really spending the scene here. I love it. I feel like I'm going to go crazy.
Which is what Floki does, right? Right at the end. Water's dripping on him. Floki screams. So because maybe Floki kind of knows that his daughter's died, he feels something inside. Or maybe he's just had it with the waterboarding and being freezing in a cave, buck naked.
There you have it. That's the end of season two. Episode two. James, let's get into predictions. Steve.
Aslaug.
Now, you're after Buzz TV.
Are you ready? Well, I love this music. It's very sci-fi. We need some more Vikings-esque predictions music. Especially when Queen Aslaug dies.
That's what you think is going to happen?
By one of her kids' hands.
Bold. So, I think it's still a little bit early for them to go back to Paris right now.
Uh-huh.
Queen Aslaug, I think Ragnar's young sons, other than Bjorn, is going to come into play, right? Because they're getting a little bit older. And I think they are going to be set up to do some things for him, either being killed their own mother, which I don't think they can do, but they're going to be coming to play.
I need something bigger.
Something bigger.
I need it. Get right to it.
This is so many storylines that it's crazy. I think Floki will not die. Floki's definitely going to stay alive.
Word.
I think Ragnar's going to let him go.
Word.
And I think Floki might leave and run away and disown Ragnar for it, because it's his daughter. The only thing that he might have loved other than himself. So I'm going to go out on a limb there. His predictions. Nobody knows what's the truth in this place in any way anymore. So I think that's about it for us. Guys.
Awesome.
James, guys, thank you so much for following us here and watching us on subscribing and watching us on YouTube and listening to us on iTunes. My name is Jaco Vennings, Vennings the Viking. You guys can catch me on Twitter and social media at Jaco Vennings. That's JacoVienings.
And I'm James Simmons. You guys can find me all over social at AskTheNP. We will be back next week talking about episodes 3 and 4. We'll cram them in together. We want to hear you guys' thoughts. We love your feedback, and we will see you next week.
Next week. Bye.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network. to watch or listen to other After Shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.